person since I was a child. I was drawn to the face and to people. I remember even back then, there were a lot of adults saying, well, why don't you draw landscapes? Why don't you do, you know, animals or other things? And it was that human face that would draw me in. And so it's just wonderful to be able to have this exhibit, which is the art of capturing character. And I think it's so telling when you get to look back through history and you see many of these drawings and paintings and the different mediums, to notice how people are actually, we haven't changed a whole lot. There are a lot of things that are still the same in our emotions and the way we see things. I wanted to start with these two and talk a little bit about self-portraits. It's interesting to me how artists are always doing self-portraits. One reason happens to be that you've got your model right there, and usually they'll cooperate with you, although sometimes, I don't know, whenever I've tried to paint myself, it doesn't always work out quite the way I expect. I think that it can be very difficult because the way we see ourselves and the way other people see ourselves is often very different. So it's actually a little bit more challenging than what you might think when you're doing a self-portrait. But what I wanted to point out about this is the two different mediums here. So we have Antonio Mancini, and he was actually an Italian artist. He lived from 1852 to 1930, and the self-portrait that we have up here was done in 1875. Now the one over here is washed, and it is Sir Hubert von Herkimer. He was German, and he lived 1849 to 1914. And this particular portrait was 1875 also. So they're both done at the same time period, but using very different mediums. What I love about this particular piece, and this is the one that's done in the black chalk, I love the expression in these eyes. It's almost as if he's caught himself by surprise. There is so much character in this piece, and what's interesting to me is really, there are not a lot of details. If you truly look at those eyes, and you look at even the beard down here, it's almost just a suggestion of it. He has not gone in there and done what today we would call photorealism, but yet this is such a powerful piece. Once again, it's simply done in chalk, but it still really grabs the viewer, and you get pulled in, and what you start wondering about is indeed the character, his character. What is it that he's trying to share with himself as an artist and also with the viewers? And one of the things that I love when I'm looking at portraits like this is looking at the rhythm that we see in people's face. That's the difference between a portrait that feels very stiff, that does not feel lifelike, and one that feels almost as if he's in front of us today. And this one truly, in my opinion, feels as if he's right here, ready to talk to us. And that's because there's this rhythm that you've got between the eyebrows, between the eyes, the way that they are correlated to each other, and also, again, the side of the face, the way this side mirrors over here. So there's this constant movement in a piece that gives you that feeling that it's alive, that he is right here in the moment with us. In this particular one, once again, I think the expression. I just love that expression. I love the eyes. Now this one is in gouache, so typically that's going to be done on paper, heavy watercolor paper. But even though it's done in gouache, it still has such a radiant feel in the face. You look at the color combinations, they use very subtle value shifts that are done on this side. But yet, you still get the feeling of that beautiful light over here. You get the expression that he too has been caught in a moment and is wanting to share something with the viewer. And of course, I love the things that do tell us a little bit about the time period, the hat that he's wearing, and then also the clothing. It's neat to be able to look back and see what the styles were at those points in time. But one things that is so powerful in both of these portraits, again, are those eyes. And I've learned it's not just the eyes in a portrait. The eyebrows play an important role in how we see the eyes. They've got so much character in them. If you take away these eyebrows and you were to just see the eyes by themselves, they're not nearly as powerful. And sometimes we as artists even overlook that. We overlook how important those eyebrows are to being able to portray the character of the, whether it's ourselves to the viewer or whether it's another person that we're painting. These two pieces are just fantastic. I love this one, the black crayon, and that's Coltina Martin Pregnard, and she is also French. It's 1885 to 1945. This is a self-portrait that she did in 1910, and it is a stunning piece. What is fantastic about it are the, once again, you've got this incredible expression, and it's hard to believe that this has just been done in crayon. You think about black crayon, and of course we're not talking about the same crayons that we've got in a crayon box that the kids would use, but still, to get such energy in that. And then the piece that's next to it over, whoops, I go back. The piece that's next to it is, too far. There we go. Alphonse Legros. And this is graphite on paper with watercolor wash. Now that's something that I find very interesting, to be able to combine those two mediums, your graphite and then also your watercolor wash. And the title of this, which is really quite interesting to me, is it's a self-portrait, but I love how he put in there, it's a self-portrait tipping his hat. And it was done in 1895. He is also French. He lived 1837 to 1911. And when you look at these two, again, take them out, a closer look at them, what it's that expression that we've got from the eyes. She is looking straight on to the viewer. I would imagine that back then, when you're trying to do a self-portrait, they would probably be looking in a mirror to be able to do this. The photography was you know, a new tool that wasn't used quite the way we use it today. But even then, to be able to look in the mirror and not have an expression that got kind of stiff as you're creating this art, but still is full of life and has this feeling that you've just kind of come upon her by chance. We're also noticing, again, how these eyebrows are creating so much of the character in her eyes. It's creating that phenomenal expression that she's got. But we don't have a lot of detail in her nose. There's very minimal detail behind her upper lip. It still is enough to give us this fantastic expression and this character that's coming out. It shows me, it's a reminder to me, that sometimes we can put too many details in a piece. A piece doesn't always need a lot of information to be effective. We do have, again, a little bit of an insight into her clothing, which is really wonderful to see what she would have been wearing at that time. And we also have this wonderful dramatic lighting here, where you've got your contrast between the light and the shadow. So she was able to do a lot with the medium that she was using. And I'm imagining that this medium was also done on probably some type of paper. Typically, that's what you would be using. Now, on this, of course, it's very light because it is the graphite. But once again, there's so much in the character with the hat, and you can see, barely see his, the outline of his hand up here. And he's also got this wonderful facial here, his beard. The eyes have so much emotion in them. Looking at him, you just feel as if he's someone you could go up and talk to. And once again, it's not easy when you're trying to pull that character out in your own self, as opposed to having a sitter. And I do believe there is a fine line when you're doing a portrait between a little trying to get the features exactly the way you see them. We all have that little bit of a caricature. People who know us will be able to, you know, there's certain features we have that they can just grab on. And sometimes artists can actually take a feature such as a nose, or the mouth, even the way that a beard is, and tweak it just a little bit so it becomes even more pronounced than it is. And that's when you get a viewer who knows the person coming up and saying, wow, you just captured them spot on. So when you're doing any type of portrait like this, it's fun to see how you're balancing that little bit of that caricature with trying to get these accurate features. I love the hand here. Talk about a really cool self-portrait. This artist is grabbing one of his own features, his hand, and I'm going to assume, because it is actually his, the title of this is the self-portrait of the right hand of the artist. So it made me think that perhaps he was left-handed, which I thought was kind of interesting. He is German, 1815 to 1905, Adolf Friedrich Erdmann von Menzel. Think about having to go around and tell people that that's your name. That's a little bit of a mouthful. But once again, this is in graphite. And I love over here a little bit more of that study that he's got. This piece is black and white chalk. So both of these are done on paper or a substrate very similar to that. And the artist over here, he was actually born in 1860. He lived in 1937. He was French too. And that was Francois Joseph Giget. It's 1880 is the year that he did this self-portrait. The hands were done in 1890, so it's similar, you know, 10 years apart. What I wanted to point out about the hands, we don't often think of a hand as being a self-portrait, but there's so much character in hands. I don't know how many of you may know this, but sometimes it is harder for an artist to capture a hand than it is to do a person's face. Hands are not easy. You look at, you've got all these digits, and you're trying to figure out how you're going to convey them without them looking like a bunch of sausages. You're trying to do that and get the nuances of the folds, the flesh, and the fingernails. And I have talked to many portrait artists who have spent just as much time, if not more time, on someone's hands, trying to get their hands, than to get their facial features. And if you are trying to do a portrait that feels like your sitter, you can't, you know, not get their hands to feel like your hands. It just doesn't work. You've got to have the whole package. So this was just one that I felt like I had to throw in there because it's very interesting. I believe just my own personal thoughts on this, that you probably realized how hard and how important it was to capture that character in a hand, and that's why he was spending some time really analyzing his own hand. And once again, it's a ready model. You've got it, you might as well work on it and be able to get in that practice time. I love this particular piece. I also really enjoy the medium of pastel, which is very similar to chalk. The fact that you can take just black and white chalk and create so much depth that's in here. And again, so much of his expression and that contact with the viewer is in these eyebrows and also in those eyes. But the eyes without the eyebrows would not convey the emotion that this particular image conveys. He has got just phenomenal use of the light and dark. I love how these eye sockets have got the dark with that little bit of the light starting to come in. It's the type of portrait where you really feel the dimension in the face. You feel, especially this forehead, you really feel that coming out and these eyes going back, being set back in the face. And once again, it's got the rhythm that we spoke about earlier, which keeps you feeling that it is lifelike, very much in front of you, that rhythm helps to create character when you're dealing with portraits. It keeps your painting or your drawing from feeling stiff. And that's just a natural way that the rhythm of these eyes relate to one another. Also, the rhythm that's going on in the eyebrows. We even got rhythm in these ears, looking at the way the one ear fits in with the other ear. And there's common rhythms here. You've got kind of this curve up here with the forehead, then it repeats itself down in the nose. And actually, even in this part of the beard, that same pattern is repeating itself. So it is not only a strong sample of a self-portrait, but it's also a very strong piece showing us once again how capturing that the rhythms of those human features really do give a piece a lot of strong character. So the next one here, now that we've gone over quite a few self-portraits, one of the other things I've noticed that artists tend to do is they have portraits of beloved people around them. This particular artist here is Sir George Hare, and he was, get my notes, he was English. This is a portrait of his beloved. And I don't know why, I guess you could say that I'm either romantic at heart or old-fashioned, but I just love that portrait of a beloved. I think that is really a wonderful title. It's pen and ink, and we don't have a higher resolution image of this particular one, but I do want to point out, once again, even though this is a full length, there are so many incredible rhythms here. We have the rhythm of the face, that shape is almost repeated here in the way that her arms are and her shoulder, and then the rhythm of the body. It's an incredible piece of art. And it was done in pen and ink, and I'm going to assume again on some type of paper. I'm still fascinated by what artists can do with just picking up pen and ink. It's incredible what they're able to capture and then convey to their viewer. This one over here is black chalk once again. And we see there's a difference between each artist, how they handle their medium. There are times where the black chalk has been very dark. We've created a lot more dimension. This one is very subtle, and it is actually done by Francis Danby. He was English. The dates of his life are 1793 to 1861. This is the artist's son, and the date of it is 1822. So we do have a higher resolution image of that. And what I wanted to share was how beautifully done this is. I happen to have two boys, and so I would say that I'm probably partial to portraits of little boys. And you just really capture, in this particular piece, he was able to capture, I believe, his love for his son. And the way he's handled, once again, the emotion in the eyes, His birth was 1865. He died in 1916. This is a portrait of the artist's wife, and it was done in 1894. Now, this particular one over here is also a portrait of the artist's wife. It's Leon Augustin Lehermitte, and he was French, 1844 to 1925. Now, what's funny is he actually entitled his portrait of the artist's wife, Eloise. He gave a name to her, whereas the other artist didn't give her name. I thought that was interesting. But it's 1890. And to me, there's such a difference between these two pieces. They're both beautifully done, but they've been handled very differently. This particular one, again, we have the very dramatic light and the dark. And she is also making eye contact with the viewer. I want to point out once more the eyebrows and how that's going to connect with these eyes. They're not very detailed, they're very subtly done, but if you took those away, you would not have this same expression that she wears. I love the way that he's taken this dark down here, it's been repeated up in the hair, and we really do get a sense of her personality. And I think everyone who looks at it may read something different into it. I personally, when I look at it, I just get this feeling of just calm. There's just something very calm and peaceful and soothing about her face. And I think the artist was able to show the feeling of love that he had. It comes through in this, in the way that he handled the medium and in the way that he has portrayed her character. This one is pastel. And this is probably one of the, it may actually be the only pastel that is in the pieces that I pulled through this talk. Pastel is just such an incredible medium, and it lasts so long if it's taken care of. We have a great legacy of pastel paintings. And I really love that in this particular one, we get to know a little bit more about her character. As someone coming in not knowing, you know, anything about her, seeing those flowers makes you wonder, as far as, was she into gardening? Did she have her own garden? She obviously must have loved the flowers. There must have been some type of connection there. I don't think it's as simple as the artist saying, okay, well, here, hold this prop. We're going to work with this. I really do think that when an artist paints a loved one, someone who's close to them, they're trying to pull certain things in that have meaning to the person who they are painting. And once again, we've got this incredible expression. And I don't want to underestimate the mouth, the power of the mouth. Mouths are not easy to capture. And it's probably because they're moving all the time. They've got these little quirks going on. But there's so much of the expression that comes from the way we hold our mouth. And if, you know, between the way her mouth is and also the way that the eyes and the way the eyebrows are corresponding to those eyes, it creates this feeling that when a viewer comes in, once again, I feel like we get a very good idea of her personality. I do not think that a painting like this would be nearly as strong if there wasn't that sense of movement going on. And all of the rhythms that I spoke about earlier are in here. The rhythm, the curve that's going this way, and we've got the same curve repeated in the eyebrows. We've got these curves under the eyes that's repeated in the nose. you've got it there, you've got the flowers, we're able to see some of the clothing, so we can place her in that particular time period. I just think that this particular piece is a joy to look at. It's got so many wonderful aspects to it. And one of the things I wanted to point out is, even the way the clothing is reflected up here in the bottom of her chin. So it's just neat to see how all of these artists have taken the use of the self-portrait and also painting people that they know and been able to convey such strong emotions through that. Well, I decided that this would be a good time to introduce a little bit of my own work. And I thought, well, they're talking about artist portraits of beloved. I'll go in and put in one of the ones that I did of my younger son. And so we call this Bringing in the Ocean. One thing I found out is sometimes you run out of titles. You're trying to look for titles for your paintings, and it's not always easy to come up with a title. I happen to work in acrylic, and I like to use acrylic the way that most artists like to use oil, and that's because I actually started out as an oil painter. And one thing I've done in this particular painting, I'm going to go to the larger image, I wanted to include something that will tell the viewer a little bit about Brennan. And so I've got his boogie board here, he's out in this ocean, and I included the way we've got arm coming up, shielding his eyes, and there is so little detail in those eyes, and yet, when I look at this, the expression is 100% him at that point, when he was probably about 6 or 7 years old. That is another reminder to me of what I said earlier, how much emotion and character we can convey without having a lot of extra detail. You've got just this little bit of light here on the nose, a little bit of hint of the mouth, and yet there's so much emotion in this piece. I think at that point he was feeling a bit overwhelmed. He wasn't quite sure if he should continue out into the water with the boogie board or if he needed to come back in. And even the way he's standing is evident of his personality. He would always stand and he'd stick that little belly out. He just had to have that out there. It's a piece that I wanted not only to be able to show my love for him, for myself, and for him as he gets older, but also hoping that it would connect with the viewer. Someone else would be able to see that moment in childhood, where you're out there in the ocean and you're feeling kind of small, and the ocean's feeling pretty large. This next one is Christian by the Sea. I couldn't do one of my younger son without including one of my older son. I had to put him in there. He was about, I'd say 10 or 11 in this particular painting. It's also acrylic on panel. And as you probably can tell by now, I handle the medium in a very loose, painterly style. I love to allow those brush strokes to sing. There's something about that. I've been very strongly influenced by the Impressionist painters and love them ever since I was probably 10 years old. So I hear there's a lot of movement going on. And this, we don't get as much of the face. It's such a subtle nuance of the face. And yet, once give the viewer a little bit of a glimpse into that. The other thing that I've tried to do, and we have noticed in some of the other portraits, was little bits of color. You have little color notes. And if they're placed in just the right places, you can use those to pull your viewer's eye around this scene. And that's very powerful, especially when you're using a painting medium. So this happens to be another one of my acrylic paintings. It's based on a photograph I took of my niece. And I titled it Transformed, because when it was finished, it had a completely different feeling than what I was actually going for. This is 8 by 10, and actually the two paintings before were both 8 by 10. When I work in acrylic, I work on a panel. I don't do as much with canvas anymore. I like the panel because it's a really nice, flat surface. It's not going to warp over time. And I just like the way it responds to the brush. This one to me came down to this expression in the eyes. Really wanted to make that work. And also, I want you to notice again, there's not a lot of detail in those eyebrows, but there's just enough that they enhance that expression that's in her eyes. And we've also got several of the rhythms repeated in this. We've got this wonderful rhythm here, this curve that's going between the eyebrows and the eyes, and we've got the curve that's here in the forehead created by the wreath that she's got in her head. We also have this curve under here, under her lower lip, is mimicking the curve under her nose. One thing I've noticed that people do, especially when they're beginner painters, they overlook that to have a simpler nose is actually a lot more powerful than to try into detail that knows too much. And I learned this best to have just enough information in that nose to make it really feel like it needs to feel, rather than breaking it up with too much. If you break it up too much, you typically end up with a little pig snout, and it's hard to go back and soften that out. So, in this particular painting, I've tried to use large forms, but yet there's a lot of movement going on. There's movement going on not only in her face with all of these brush strokes and different textures, but there's also movement around her and movement that's interacting with her. The background has actually become part of her. It's not separate. You're trying to look for ways to merge that background with your character who's in it, and not leave them feeling like they've been pasted on afterwards. But there are, even the use of color, the color that's behind, around her eyes, over here, in her hair, and down into her ear, and under her chin, lends itself to this whole feeling of this very determined, almost trying to think of what word I want to use to describe her. She just has this wonderfully intense connection with the viewer, and yet she's not looking quite at the viewer, but there still is this connection that you feel. This next piece is a very small one. It's instead of a suggestion. We've seen enough of the way her mouth is being held to hear that enhances the expression she has. And even her nose, we've got, you know, some of it hidden over here, but that's okay because we're able to see enough of it in the light for it to be a powerful portrait, even with half of the face in shadow. This particular one was done on a little bit different surface than the ones before it. It's a playboard surface. And so it's got this very smooth surface. And when you apply the paint, that's one of the reasons why it's easy to scratch away some of these areas. I also look for ways that I can create different textures to keep the viewer interested in these. And what I mean by different textures is I'm not always handling the paint the same way. This is a different way of handling the paint compared to what I've done up here on the head. So I'm trying to break up a pattern, and that's what keeps my viewer interested and keeps them right in here coming back to that, because everything is not the exact same treatment. This is also a small one. It's We Dreamed of Peter Pan. It's a 5x7. And once again, it has been subtly stated, but the information that is here is enough. It works. I put a lot more into this ear because to me, that just speaks volumes of the character of this particular child. We just get a little bit of nuance there with the mouth, a little bit of the nose, but it's this wonderful warmth in the ear, the color that's in the hair. I love the shape of the head, and I love the way he's holding his head, the way the neck is holding that head up. And once again, you get this tone of body language, even though there's not a lot of information in here. What artists tend to do and try to do to convey things to their viewer is to have a look of the cool contrasted with the warm. That's just a wonderful tool that can be used. Here's some artists that modern day artists who have been very inspirational to me. I wanted to touch on them because I think their work is just phenomenal. This is Jeffrey Heim. He is an oil painter. One of the things that he uses to bring out his character on the subjects are these incredible use of color. I mean, you've just got powerful, cool tones here combined with the warmth over there. We often hear people say, you know, what is flesh tone? There's really not a flesh color because, first of all, we're all coming from different backgrounds, various cultures, and there is no one flesh tone. What I love about Jeffrey Heim's paintings are how he's able to take these colors that you would never think of to put into a face and use that to bring this person's personality out. And also, the viewer has a very definite reaction to it because of those colors used. You've got this incredible magenta up here in this corner, and it's actually brought down into the features of the face, the nose, the mouth, and down here into the neck. Huang Ho is another artist who is a modern day artist, and his work is just, I think it's fabulous. He is also what I would call a little bit looser with his brush strokes, very painterly. In this particular piece, he has decided to put his subject, and you get a profile, and he's in this background with all these different nuances going on. You've got the boat here, sailboat. We don't really know what's happening here, but it's very interesting. We know we've got some baseboard going on there, we've got a floor, he's on this stool. I love how he's able to take and marry this background with his subject, being at the same time, his subject stands out. It has a definite presence. We cannot see a lot of these features because of the shadow. And yet, we still can tell a lot about this man in the way that he's holding his not only does it have the rhythms going on in the head and, you know, here in the nose and in the ear, but in this body, he's got rhythms where he's repeated things. And of course, this wonderful, incredible plaid design, which is not too stiff. It still has this feeling of movement. This is Kevin Belfis. He's also an oil painter. And I think you'll agree with me that he just has got this amazing use of color and paint, really bringing the background with his focal point, with the figure, but yet also has this figure who's making connection with the viewer, her face, very powerfully. She's able to have this strong emotion connect with the viewer. I love, again, the use of different shapes that you can see repeated. This shape here, almost this triangular shape here, that's repeated throughout in the background. And the way he marries the colors, he brings them around. He brings the same green. You can see it in her face in different areas. The blue is brought around the picture. So the viewer gets a very strong sense of this young woman and also the setting that she's in. Now this artist, Jan Roderick, is an acrylic artist also. And in this particular piece, she uses so much subtlety to really convey this feeling of youth and this young girl to the viewer. A lot of lost and found edges up here, the way her hair just goes right up into that background. We don't even see that defined the edge. Same thing down here with the clothing going right into the background. So she becomes one unit. And she's also chose to allow the viewer to connect.